your life. Tonight, I've joined the BEA ground staff here at London's International Airport. I'm here to meet a plane that's carrying our globe-trotting guest from her home in Switzerland. Now, this lady, this world-famous lady, causes a stir wherever she goes, and tonight is no exception. Already the newsman and cameraman are lined up, but she's expecting the cameras and the lights, but she's not expecting me. So any second now, let's go. Right, Douglas? One second, I have a very special message for you.
No! Yes. No, David, don't do this to me!
Come here.
Oh, my God! Oh, no!
Virgo, you know, an invitation to Thames Television because international singing star Shirley Bassey.
No, no.
This is your life and what fun it's going to be.
Oh, you did this to me! Oh.
Sergio, you know we have all the transport arranged. As soon as you're through customs, we have so many surprises waiting for you.
Oh, no.
Oh, you did it. Oh, we've been watching the sky. Come on, we'll give you time to get your back. You have to go through. I'll see you in a minute.
Okay.
Well, for 1 minute there, Shirley, I thought you were going to take flight back from Milan without an aeroplane.
I nearly did, I tell you.
Shirley Bassey, this is your life, a brilliantly successful but sometimes stormy, headline-making life that's taken the girl who sang above the roar of machinery in a Cardiff factory to fame as an international star. Described by Earl Wilson, one of America's leading columnists, as the world's greatest female entertainer. A title you've been earning since your first hit in 1957.
I will love you as I love you all my life.
To only 3 weeks ago at New York's Waldorf Astoria.
Dream, a child's dream of applause like that when you started singing and the first audience and the first stage were very different.
Well, I was the audience and she sang to me under the kitchen table.
Of course it is. From Cardiff, your mother, Mrs. Eliza Bassey.
No, of course you didn't. You sit over there, Eliza, beside her.
I didn't now, expect you either, Mother.
I want you to tell me why she sang under the kitchen table.
Well, she was afraid, you know, she was shy. And of course, she always wanted to go under the table, and she had more confidence then.
But she overcame that shyness as a teenager to enter a local talent competition. Tell us about that competition.
Well, she won the second prize. She had £5.
Well, what did you do with the £5 that
she
won?
She bought me a ring with three stones in it for £4.5.
£4.5 out of the five.
Yeah.
Well done. Well, Shirley, born in the docklands of Tiger Bay, Cardiff, you were raised here at 132 Portnamore Road. Your father died when you were only a baby of two, and things were hard when you were growing up during the war, but as a teenager, you could always earn extra pocket money just a few doors up from the street from where you're singing in the Splott Working Men's Club. See it there, I'm sure you remember it. Perhaps better known to you by another name. Do you remember the other name? It was the Bomb and Dagger. The Bomb and Dagger, where you found your first fans, but they weren't as appreciative of the bassy voice back home.
Not when she was singing into my ear at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Another bassy voice, yes, your sister Marina here tonight from Cardiff with your other sisters, Eileen, Iris, and Ella. And your brother Henry. Now tell me, what was it that what song was she singing into your ear at 5 o'clock in the morning?
I can't remember the title of the song, but it was just one big noise at that hour.
So you weren't exactly a fan of hers then?
No. You're right.
What was the situation when this singing took place? Where were you all?
Well, we were three of us in a bed together.
And what was the battle for?
Well, the middle of the bed. That was the snuggest.
I always ended up in the middle, though.
Yeah, you're right.
I always lost the battle.
And would she really sing at 5 in the morning?
She would. She was always singing.
But Eileen, as a child, you had problems actually getting her to open her mouth.
Yes, Eamon. But Shirley always had this habit, you know, twirling this bit of hair, sucking the thumb at the same time, you know, and left her with a lisp.
Sucking the thumb, left her with a lisp.
Yes. So when she sang "Kiss Me, Honey, Honey, Honey," it came out like "Kiss Me, Honey, Honey, Kiss Me."
And Henry, how about you? You're Eileen's twin. How was the beat of the only son in the house?
Bloody murder. Shirley was the worst.
I bet she was. Well, Shirley, I know that your mum here had a tough time bringing up such a large family, but it was a very happy home, wasn't it?
Yes, we were, yes, very happy.
Exactly 1 week, Shirley, after your 15th birthday, you left Splott Secondary Modern to take your first job here at Curran's Engineering Works in Cardiff. Every day for the next 18 months, you worked here on this very assembly line, packing saucepans for less than £3 a week. You're one of the stars of the Works baseball team, right? You're second on the left there.
Oh, I guess. That's the closest. And when Cassie's playing.
I say your costumes have changed slightly now for your public appearances, haven't they?
So is my facial expressions.
And every Wednesday night you're off to the Factory Sports and Social Club for a sing-song with your workmates. And tonight we're taking you back to that club to meet again those friends you've never forgotten. And I know I've never forgotten you and the songs you sung. Played for you tonight, as she did then, Mrs. Dorothy Bennett, and sung by some of your friends still working at that same factory.
Walking my baby back home.
Hello, Shirley. Do you remember when we worked together and the day Miss O'Neill sent for me to ask you if you could keep your voice down? She didn't mind you singing, but not so loudly.
I remember that, Josie. We used to work on the belt together. But still, Shirley, I didn't mind you singing. We all thought it was great.
Now, you haven't seen that club for nearly 20 years, but you're going to meet those friends sooner than thought, because they're here now. Come in. Dorothy Bennett, Terry Edwards, George and Nancy Llewellyn, and Josie Downey. Mrs. Bennett, I believe she used to give you a bit of trouble with her songs, right?
She certainly did. She used to say to me, don't play, Mrs. Bennett, because I'll sing out a tune. I said, never mind, Shirl, have a bash. I'll follow you, even if it means playing on all the black notes.
Well, while still packing pots by day, you began singing at night at the Cardiff clubs. Then in 1954, you're noticed by a local agent who gives you your first job in a touring revue called Memories of Al Jolson. You leave the security of your home, and for the next 6 months, you tour with this revue. In that show, you sang a duet with a man you called Uncle Ed. And Uncle Ed is here tonight, comedian Eddie Reindeer. Called you Uncle Ed, but you had a pet name for her too, hadn't you?
Yeah, well, we used to have a little game switching names, and one day she called me Reddy Reindeer, and I called her Burly Chassis.
That's how it got
about. Yeah, yes.
Burly Chassis.
Also helped you, didn't you, Eddie, with her very first record?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Well, you see, the show was coming off at Wood Green, and I thought, now, if I make a test record with her, I might get her on the discs, you see. So we went up to a little place just off Shaftesbury Avenue, didn't we?
Yes.
And we made this little record. As a matter of fact, we made two. One for Shirley to take home to her dear mum, and one for me to take round the record companies. Well, I didn't have any luck with mine. I couldn't whip up any interest at that particular moment. But that is show business. Yeah. But Mum had a lot of luck with hers, didn't you, Mum? As a matter of fact, it was worn out in about 6 weeks. But I've got mine here now.
No.
Would you like to hear it?
Never been broadcast before, but we have, as Ed says, that one copy. And Shirley, this is what you and Eddie sounded like 18 years ago.
By the light of the silvery moon,
of the silvery moon,
I love to spoon,
I love to spoon,
with my honey and the croon,
love's
honeymoon,
honeymoon,
we'll be shining in June,
we'll be shining in June,
your silvery beams will
you're out of work. It's a single ticket back home to your mum and to Cardiff, and there you take a job as a waitress. It looks as if your career is over before it really begins. Then one day, a telegram arrives inviting you to London for an audition at 5 o'clock in the afternoon of February the 14th, 1955. The audition was successful, and soon you're singing at a Mayfair night spot, the Astor Club. Now, one man who knows about that, who is at this moment in Spain, but just before he left, he told us about the call that he made to you, and here he is, Michael Sullivan.
Hello, Eamon. Hello, Shirley. I want to recall the night at the Astor Club that Jack Hilton was there by accident. And as usual, you finished your cabaret act on stormy weather, and as usual, I got the shiver down my spine. But fortunately, he did that night, too. As he turned to me and he said, my leading lady at the Adelphi has fallen sick, Mike, and could your girl open tomorrow night? I looked a little bewildered and said, well, sure. But I wasn't too sure whether he was serious. So I didn't tell you until the following morning. I then called at your hotel, and you were staggered like I was. We ran to the Adelphi. We went through all the rehearsals, which were long and strenuous. And if you remember, we were still rehearsing when the people were actually walking in the theater. The critics were there, and that night they claimed you as the great new find. And that's what you were. Michelle, God bless you.
Thank you, Michael Sullivan. Well, it was a fantastic moment, and as Michael said, next morning the papers were hailing the birth of a new star. And you, Mrs. Bassey, received a very special telegram at home that day.
Yes. She said, I want you all to come to London. She said, if you haven't got the money, she said, borrow it. She said, and I'll pay you when you come to London.
Well, that was the result of the call you made following the telegram, and you all did go, and you were there at the Adelphi, and a few weeks later, at Shirley's first night, when she starred at the Café de Paris. Now, that night, everyone wanted to come back to your small dressing room there, but you only allowed two, there was only room anyway, to have this picture taken here. You see it over there, a picture of your mother and the man you dedicated one of your songs to. A keen fan has been at many of your opening nights since, one of the stars of this year's Royal Variety Performance, top international entertainer, and he's here, Liberace. I believe, Lee, that your admiration for Shirley's singing caused you a little trouble in traffic recently, right?
Well, that's true. I don't think Shirley knows this, but I have all of your records, and I stopped to pick up your latest one at the time, which was a car tape of something else.
Yeah.
And I put it in my car, and I got on the Los Angeles freeway, and I'm driving along, and all of a sudden, you came to this fabulous song called Excuse Me.
Yeah.
And I couldn't drive and listen at the same time, so I pulled into an illegal zone so I could listen to your record, and I almost got arrested. and a cop pulled by, you know, and he said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "I'm listening to Shirley Bassey." And he looked at me as though I was, you know, gone potty. And but I love you so much, and I have all your records.
What makes you admire her so much as an artist, Lee?
Well, Shirley is the stuff that stars, superstars, are truly made of. Everything she sings is from within. She is an intense singer, an exciting singer, an electric performer, and I've seen her take an audience and put it right in that magic hand of hers. And only a great, great artist with great talent can do that. And she is that.
Thank you. Well, Shirley, it's impossible to stop you singing on stage or off. And one Christmas, when you decide to liven the party up with a song, you even bring your hostess in on the act. That hostess retired from stage nearly 20 years ago, but she's making a comeback for you tonight, a great variety star once billed as the voice of the stars, your good friend, comedian, and impressionist, Florence Desmond. Tell me, how did Shirley begin her impromptu cabaret?
Well, I could tell you many stories about Shirley, but this Christmas party was really one of the funniest, because you don't have to ask Shirley to sing. She just does it at the drop of a hat. But it so happened that we did have a wonderful pianist there, and she sang and she sang and she sang, and then we arranged a little joke. I got dressed up in the most awful tatty drag, and my husband, at a given cue, turned on the radiogram, and I came on in this awful tatty drag, and I did Big Spender to Shirley's playback. Well, then later on in the evening, about 2 o'clock in the morning, Shirley fortunately took off her stiletto heels and got on the billiard table and did Big Spender to her own record. Then she asked me to join her, which I must say was an awful lot of fun, really, doing that.
The two of you together?
Yes, we did. It was kind of a funny double act.
It was very funny double act.
Yeah, it was a funny double act.
Yes.
On the billiard table.
On the billiard. You wouldn't like to repeat it, Michelle.
We haven't got a billiard table.
I would like to repeat
it. Well, do it then. Yes, come on.
Come on. You're kidding. Come on.
Piano. You started off, and I'll stop right.
The minute you are in the joint, distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. So wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my mind? So let me get right to the point. I every man I see. Big spender, spend a little time with me.
Hey, Big spenders. Thank you.
It was funnier than that at the time.
Beautiful.
We started the show.
Oh, boy. Shirley, by the mid-60s, you're a household name. You had great success in your career, but less so in your personal life. Sadly, in 1965, you were divorced from the man who for many years had been both husband and manager, the late Kenneth Hume. It's a tough time for you, facing the world alone and your critics alone, until 2 years later when you re-meet the man who was by your side tonight, Sergio. Tell us how that re-meeting happened, will you?
Well, I met her first in 62, and for 6 years we missed each other many times, tried to get together, never made it, until in 68, I was in Milan, and all of a sudden I pick up a paper and I read that Shirley Bassey is in Milan for some television. So I said, this time must be the one. So I called the hotel where she was staying, and finally, after 5-6 tries, I get her. So I say, hello, here is Sergio. I says, Sergio who? I says, Sergio Novak. Novak? Yes, I said, Venice, you remember? Venice? I says, Venice, no. The Excelsior, the Lido. So finally I mentioned the name of the person who introduced us. He says, Johnny Johnston. Oh, yes, yes, how are you? Very nice, well, fantastic. Huh? He says, well, how long are you staying? I'm leaving tomorrow. I says, leaving tomorrow. I said, my God, all that stuff like. But anyway, he says, would you like to come for dinner? Oh, no, I'm exhausted. He says, I'm exhausted. I had the television. So I really thought this is it. So he says, but why don't you come over for a drink? So I said, all right. So, you know, I went over for the drink. Then we met the next week in Rome, and
those dates were the first of many. And on the 12th of August, 1958, you marry in Las Vegas with your two daughters, Sharon and Samantha, as bridesmaids. Well, today you're settled in Switzerland, a center for your worldwide travel, and you're happiest when you're with your family. Your 8-year-old daughter Samantha and 5-year-old Mark, the boy you and Sergio hope soon to adopt. Tonight, too young to be here, they're tucked up in bed at home. But in fact, there was someone missing from that film. Your eldest daughter, Sharon, at boarding school near Geneva. But tonight she isn't. We've flown her here to share this moment with you. Sharon!
No! I cried as well.
Shirley, today you are one of the world's top cabaret actors.
That's what we got when you were sleeping, baby.
Things always don't go smoothly. One night in New York, Shirley, at the Waldorf Hotel, where you've just had such a great success, you're singing The Lady is a Tramp. On stage behind you, the orchestra is conducted by a man who, when you're partway through, hears you gasp.
And when I turned round, I could see why she was gasping, and I gasped too.
Yes, your musical director and good friend, Brian Fay. During that number, then?
Well, actually, what had happened, I realized something was wrong from the tone of her voice, and she wasn't wearing anything like she's wearing tonight, but the strap behind had broken. She was standing singing like this. So...
what did you do?
Well, I think I aged about half a century in 3 seconds. So I thought, well, at the end of the number, she has to go into the bumps and grind sequence where she has to walk around with the microphone. So I thought, well, what can I do? So I went over and actually held the straps together behind her, and she did the business. We went. What were you doing? Did you sing? I don't know.
I like
down
the sound there. Of three grass through my head. Da 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 da. That's down. That's down. Don't like that deep. That's why the lady is a tramp. So yes, I'm a tramp.
And she finished the whole act like that. And the following day, it was in Earl Wilson's column, and the management of the Waldorf said, could we keep it in every night? They
thank you, Brian Fay, thank you. Wherever you go, you earn the respect and admiration of people who work with you, particularly the musicians. Now, one such musician who's on stage tonight in New York sends you his message, one of the world's most famous pianist composers, Count Basie.
Guess who?
Yes, Daddy.
You know what? I tell you, while I'm here in New York at the Royal Box, the Americana, and I'm awfully sorry that I can't be there with you on your very special night, which is a very special night, which you so richly deserve. You know, I can remember, Shirley, when we were together when you had your show, and the band and I were together with you, and it was such a ball doing the thing with you, and it was just great, and you were just marvelous. And when I saw the show, we were all very excited and very wild about it. It was just great. And you know, it seems as though we've been missing each other all down the line, because we just missed you in Las Vegas, and we just barely missed you here in New York when you were at the Waldorf, and I got such wonderful news that you broke all existing records there. Very wonderful. So just one thing, just when are you gonna give me another gig?
Yeah.
Thank you, Count Basie. I know not leaving America just yet. Stay watching that screen, because 700 miles further west in Milwaukee, there's someone who married and left your family home 25 years ago to live there. Yes, your sister, Grace.
Hello, Eamon. Hello, Shirley. Eamon, I have something to tell you. Last Christmas, Shirley sent me a ticket to come to England, so we could all be together the first time in 25 years. And by one day, we missed each other. So have a good time. God bless you.
But you're not going to miss it this time, because for the first time in 25 years, all the Basie clan are here for that reunion. Come in, Grace. This is your life.